Welcome to AP Calculus BC. This is section 4.1. We're going to talk about the chain rule. Now, the title of this entire chapter is More Derivatives. So we are going to further our knowledge of how derivatives work. We learned some nice rules in the last chapter for quickly dealing with derivatives, but that was still just a basic working knowledge of some certain types of functions. But there are certainly plenty more to deal with, and it's nice that our textbook at least breaks this down into manageable chapters. It's not just throwing all of derivatives at you in one chapter. It's a nice breakdown. So today we're going to learn about the chain rule. We have seen this in honors pre-calc, a cursory glance only, but for our joke of the day and to get things started on a calculus level, for chain rule, I thought of chain, I thought of a chain chomp from Mario Brothers. And when I thought of drool, or I thought of rule, I immediately thought of drool, like Homer Simpson, thinking about donuts or something. So I thought, what would it look like if we take chain and combine it with drool? What would chain drool look like? So we had some fun with Photoshop and came up with an image of chain drool. So what is the chain rule really used for? Well, right now our derivatives work for if our function is a basic function. But what if it's more complicated? In other words, what if the function we're trying to differentiate is actually a composition? There's many levels to that function. There's an inside thing and an outside thing. Or there may be an inside thing, and then an outside thing. The chain rule allows us to take such functions and break them down. The textbook definition says that if our function f is differentiable at the point where u equals another function, and that inside function is differentiable at x, then the composite function f of g of x, and I just noticed I left a parenthesis off, it's differentiable at x, and furthermore, f of g prime of x, in other words, the derivative of that composition, is the derivative of f with respect to the function inside times the derivative of that inside function, g prime of x. In Leibniz notation, that's the dy dx notation. Here we've got the same definition for y being a function of u, where u itself is another function, g of x, and it says that to take that derivative dy dx, I derivate y, the outside function, with respect to u, the inside function, times then the derivative with respect to u of the inside function, or the derivative of the inside function with respect to x, du dx. The way that you're going to hear me recite this over and over again is the outside derivative of the inside thing times the derivative of the thing inside. And just a nice way, if you recite this to yourself, to commit that to memory and put that into use. Now, this process can also be repeated if we have functions within more functions. In other words, there's more links to our chain than just one. And it works just like you'd expect. And furthermore, we can apply the process of the chain rule to deal with parametric functions. That's where each point x is its own function. Each point y is found by its own function. So if those two functions are differentiable at a certain parameter t, then to find dy dx, I derivate y with respect to t and put that over the derivative of x with respect to t. Very much like dealing with a chain rule problem, because it is a chain rule. First example, here we've got three different cases where we have a composition of functions and we have to find the derivative of that composition. All right, so for letter A, I've got 5 times cotangent of 2 over x, and here the book is already giving me a substitution saying, hey, let that inside function be 2 over x. All right, well, outside derivative, so I need to derivate cotangent. That's my outside function. The derivative of 5 times cotangent, well, remember cotangent goes to cosecant squared, negative cosecant squared. So y prime equals negative 5 cosecant squared of that inside thing of 2 over x times the derivative of the thing inside. And I'm just going to pause for a second. That thing inside is like 2x to the negative first. The derivative of that, I would apply the power function, negative 2x to the negative second. multiply the negative 1 out front and drop the exponent 1. Okay, we can clean house. I've got a negative 5 times a negative 2. That would be positive 10. Cosecant squared of 2 over x. And that's all over x squared. I can move that x to the negative second to a place in the denominator. Of course, negative exponents mean reciprocal. So there we have our derivative using the chain rule, a pretty basic one-link chain. For letter B, okay, here we've got, you can tell inside we don't just have a regular x, we have a function based on x. That's true with both of our functions, so we're going to have two chains to deal with, not referring to the rap artist, of course. So y equals, okay, let's deal with that first term. Okay, we've got basically our sum formula for derivatives acting here. The derivative of sine, that's the outside function, is cosine of that inside thing times the derivative of the thing inside. Well, since 3 pi over 2 is a coefficient on x, the derivative is just that coefficient. Plus, the derivative of cosine is negative sine of the inside thing times the derivative of the thing inside. And again, we can clean this up. 3 pi times cosine, 3 pi over 2x, all over 2. It's not going to be plus anymore. Minus sine of, and let's put that 7 pi out in front. That's part of our numerator. And if we wanted, we could get a common denominator and combine those together even more. But this is a fully functional derivative, so we'll just leave that be as it is. If we start to get a common denominator, sometimes it just makes the end result more complex. All right, letter C. What I've got here in my square root of secant x plus tangent x is secant x plus tangent x to the one-half power. Okay, so let's deal with that, because now it's not just x raised to a power. I've got a function raised to a power, so that function is going to be my inside thing. All right, so outside derivative of the inside thing. I've got 4 times secant x plus tangent x. Oop, and sorry, I should have moved that 1/2 power out front. 4 times 1/2 secant x tangent x to the negative 1/2 power, drop the exponent, times the derivative of the thing inside. Derivative of secant is secant x tangent x. Plus derivative of tangent is secant squared x. So there's my chain rule. Outside derivative of the inside thing times the derivative of the thing inside. Well, there's plenty of cleaning up to do. 4 times 1/2 is 2. And then if that secant x tangent x, secant x plus tangent x, is to the negative 1/2 power, then it's like being a square root in the denominator. And I think it's pretty self-explanatory why I'm trying to combine this together more than the earlier examples. Our first line here is pretty much a mess. Then what do I have in the numerator? I've got secant x. I can take a greatest common factor of secant x out of there. And then it's going to be tangent x plus secant x. Now, it's not considered proper to leave this square root in the denominator, so I'm going to multiply numerator and denominator by root secant x plus tangent x. Okay. And what I get is I essentially created in my denominator by squaring secant x plus tangent x when I multiply those two together, my denominator is going to become just regular secant x plus tangent x. That's what I get when I square those square roots. So I've got 2 times secant x times, I'm just going to switch the order here, secant x plus tangent x. It means the same thing as what I had in this quantity right here, times the square root of secant x plus tangent x. I know it seems like I'm making this more complicated, but just trust me. And then our denominator became secant x plus tangent x, and we get to cancel out that factor. So ultimately, our derivative, y prime, 2 times secant x times the square root secant x plus tangent x. It's always a pretty good feeling once we get a problem like that done and we get a nice big factor like secant x plus tangent x to cancel out. So, okay, example 2. Here we're looking at the chain rule as it's explicitly defined, finding the derivative of a composition of two functions. And once again, the textbook has given us a nice definition for what the inside thing is, what that inside function represents. So the outside derivative of the inside thing is what we're going to be dealing with. If I'm trying to take f prime of u, it's the outside derivative of the inside thing, then I get derivative of that first part of our sum. And for the second part, I hope that we can see this as the cosine of u raised to the negative second power. So what I'm doing is I'm adding to that the derivative of cosine of u to the negative second power. And outside derivative of the inside thing, here I've got negative 2 times cosine of u times the derivative of the thing inside. The thing inside is cosine u, which I should have dropped that exponent to a negative 3. The derivative of that thing inside, derivative of cosine, is negative sine of u. And then that itself is another chain. I need to multiply in u prime. So there's an example of a composition of functions. We had a function u inside a cosine, which was being raised to a power. So a 3-link chain there. All right. Well, if the function u means g of x, then f prime of g of x then equals u prime, which is g prime of x, minus 2 times the cosine of g of x to the negative third power. I need another parenthesis there, and times negative sine of g of x times g prime of x. Wow, we're getting into the thick of it right away. If that's g of x, then g prime of x has to equal just pi. So let's take a look at if we actually start plugging in those pi x's and pi, that's where we start to see f of g, that big derivative with respect to x. Well, g prime of x is just pi, and then I've got minus 2 times the cosine of pi x to the negative third power times the negative sine of pi x times g prime of x, which we just said was pi. So managing this 3-link chain is somewhat burdensome. We're going to find that it's much easier to clearly note our steps as we go along. Take our time. Keep organized. So f of g prime of x now equals, and you know what? I'm pretty comfortable at this point. We've got it clearly laid out. We're supposed to evaluate this when x is 1/4. Let's go ahead and substitute in that 1/4. We've got clear places where we input our x values. So I've got pi, And then negative 2, that cosine of pi x, if I plug in a 1/4 for x, that's going to be the cosine of pi over 4 to the third power, and it's acting in a denominator, right? We're dealing with that negative exponent. Then I'm multiplying in a negative sine of pi x, that's pi over 4 when I substitute in x, and then I'm multiplying that by pi. So I've just turned this entire chunk here into a big fraction so I could properly see the cosine in the denominator. Okay, well, by now, after going through trig last year, we should be very comfortable with sine and cosine of pi over 4. It's just a matter of cleaning house now. So I've got big pi out front, plus 2 times the sine of pi over 4 is root 2 over 2, times another pi, all over. In the denominator, we've got root 2 over 2, all of that cubed, because the cosine at pi over 4 is also root 2 over 2. Okay, let's just work with this. Clearly, that's where our simplifying has to take place. 2 times root 2 over 2 is simply root 2 pi. And then in the denominator, if I cube the cubed root of 2, it will be 2 root 2. And then that's divided by 2 cubed, 8. And we'll go ahead and make another line here for f of g prime at x equals 1/4. So I've got pi plus, if I multiply that root 2 pi over 1 times the reciprocal, 8 over 2 root 2 of what was our denominator, we find that the root 2's cancel, and 8 over 2 simplifies to 4 over 1. So really, I'm taking pi plus 4 pi, our final answer, 5 pi. So it's pretty easy to see that as soon as we add a third link into that chain, when our composition involves more than just one function and another, if there's three functions nested in a composition, that third link certainly does add quite a bit of difficulty. But really, it wasn't anything that we couldn't handle. We just had to be sure that we kept everything organized, that we didn't lose any links in the chain along the way. Had to make sure that everything was accounted for. So clearly showing steps, huge, huge impact on how that problem goes. All right. Example 3, here we need to find the equation of the tangent line to the curve at the point defined by the given value of t. All right, well, since I know I'm going to have to find a tangent line, before I start messing up my paper with all this work to find the actual slope, to find our derivative, let's find what that point of tangency is going to be. Because once we do all that work with the slope, we're going to need a point to go with it in order to write the equation of that tangent line. Well, the point of tangency is going to be found by taking x of t, comma, y of t. It should be blatantly obvious that we're dealing with a parametric function here, especially when we see t come into play. And each function x and y, each point's defined by its own function. Okay, well, x of t is simply the sine of 2 pi times negative 1/6, negative pi over 3. And cosine follows suit, cosine of negative pi over 3. So here is a negative pi over 3 radian angle. The sine at negative root 3 is negative root 3 over 2 at a negative pi over 3 angle. And cosine is a positive 1/2. We're going to want to hang on to that point of tangency. Well, to derivate dy dx with a parametric function, we simply take the derivative of y with respect to t, its parameter, over the derivative of x with respect to t, its parameter. And this should make perfect sense because we know that the change in y over the change in x, that's what determines slope. And this is that's exactly what it's dealing with, a change of y with respect to t over the change in x with respect to t. So let's find let's find dy dt first. So the derivative of y with respect to t, I'm just derivating this cosine function. And since it's not just a cosine of t, there's an inside function, it's 2 pi t, that's where our chain rule applies. Outside derivative of the inside thing. Derivative of cosine is negative sine of that 2 pi t. Times the derivative of the thing inside, the derivative of 2 pi t, since we're going with respect to t, that's where our power rule applies, it's just 2 pi. Similarly, dx dt, now I'm looking at this sine function here and derivating that with respect to t. The outside derivative of sine is cosine of that inside thing, 2 pi t, times the derivative of the thing inside. And again, since we're derivating with respect to t, t is acting like what our x typically would. It's the one that's obeying the power rule. So derivative of 2 pi t is simply 2 pi. Okay, so if we're trying to find that slope when t equals negative 1/6, what we get is our slope at negative 1/6 is negative sine, well here, let's put that 2 pi out front, I don't want to lose that, negative 2 pi times the sine of, substituting that negative 1/6, negative pi over 3, over, now let's deal with our dx dt, the denominator, that's 2 pi times the cosine. Of negative pi over 3. Sorry for the announcement in there. Well, we're fortunate that the 2 pi's cancel out, so we can go ahead and substitute the values, the same ones that we used for our point of tangency, and I get negative, okay, we said the sine was a negative root 3 over 2, so that becomes positive root 3 over 2, over, now just the positive cosine, that's 1/2, I end up with a slope of positive root 3. So now to actually create our tangent line, now we're back to algebra 1. We've got our slope, we've got our point, y minus y1 equals m times x minus x1. If I distribute that root 3, when I multiply that in with root 3 over 2, the root 3's, I'm squaring a square root essentially, they become just 3/2. I need to add over 1/2 to both sides. Y equals root 3x plus 3/2 plus another 1/2 is just 2. So a lot of little pieces at work, but as long as we take care of finding the point of tangency, as long as we are careful when we find our derivative of parametrics, we're in good shape. It's just like we practiced all year. Okay, now, for example 4, you can see that they give us a function, y equals x squared plus 7x minus 5. We have to evaluate dy dt, okay, starting to look parametric there, when x equals 1 and dx dt equals 1/3. This problem is actually very, very quick. If we remember that with parametrics, dy dx is equal to dy dt over dx dt, we should be able to plug in everything that we need. So dy dx is really y prime, and if I were to derivate x squared plus 7x minus 5, the power rule makes short work of that. It's just 2x plus 7, so I'm going to hang on to that. That's going to take this place. Then we know dx dt is 1/3, so I know 1/3 is taking that place. And I know my x value is supposed to be 1, so I can plug that into y prime and find out what number y prime at x equals 1, what that slope is. Okay, so y prime at 1, what that equals is 2 times 1 plus 7, it's 9. So again, very short work of this. If I take that original parametric definition of a derivative, what I've got is the equation 9 equals that dy dt we're trying to find over 1/3. And multiply both sides by 1/3, 3 is our answer. So it's a great example, and I've included it here because the way that it's worded can kind of be confusing. But once we realize that they're talking about a parametric definition, it's not too hard to deal with. And this last example, seeing a table expressing different values of a function f, a function g, and the derivatives of each at certain x values, very, very common to see on the AP exam. So this is definitely something we want to pay attention to. And it's actually very, very easy as long as we don't try to establish what function they are. They are just assessing our ability to work with the derivative rules. So letter A, we're trying to find the derivative of that combination of functions. Well, here it's just a sum rule, so the derivative will be 5 times f prime of x minus g prime of x. And since I'm working when x equals 1 for this particular problem, I'm taking 5 times what's f prime at 1, negative 1/3. Minus what's g prime at 1, negative 8/3. So really, I'm saying what's negative 5/3 plus 8/3? That's 3/3. My answer is 1. Okay, for letter B, be careful. It's easy to think, oh, it's just f prime of x and then 3 times g squared of x. But there's more at play here. I got the product of two functions, and my product rule says first times derivative of second, and look out, derivative of the second is a chain rule. So the outside derivative is 3 times g of x squared times the derivative of the thing inside. And now remember, this is all part of a bigger product rule. That's the first part, first times derivative of second. Plus, now I take the second piece times the derivative of the first. And now we can substitute in our values. We're working where x equals 0 in this case. So function f at 0, that's a 1, times 3 times g at 1, that's regular function g, squared times g prime when x is 0, 1/3. Plus g cubed at x, here's g of x, 1 cubed, times f prime of x when x is 0, that's a 5. Now we just use our order of operations. I've got 1 times, that's going to become 3, times 1/3, okay, 1, plus 1 times 5, 5, my final answer is 6. So a very, very quick way for the makers of this problem to assess, do we know our derivative rules, and then can we use the proper values to come up with a simple answer? So use the rules and substitute. Right, two more. G of f of x, where x is 0. Well, composition of functions, here is our chain rule. I've got the outside derivative of the inside thing, so g prime of f of x, times the derivative of the thing inside. Okay, I'm working where x is 0, so really this is like g prime of, wait, let's see what f of x is when x is 0. F of x is 1 when x is 0, so g of 1 times f prime of x. Well, what's g prime of 1? That's negative 8/3 times f prime. I'm dealing with an x value of 1. Oops. Dealing with an x value of 0, sorry. So f prime at 0 is 5. Negative 40/3 should be our answer. And realize the only reason I looked at 1 here was because that came from f of 0. And lastly, brace yourselves, big chain happening here. So outside derivative of the inside thing is negative 2 times g of x plus f of x, our inside thing, drop that exponent, times the derivative of the thing inside, that's g prime of x plus f prime of x, just applying our sum rule for derivatives. And here we're working where x equals 1, so I've got negative 2 over g of x when x is 1, that's negative 4, plus f of x, we're at negative 1, 3 cubed, times, now what's g prime of x? G prime of x when x is 1, negative 8 thirds, plus f prime of x when x is 1, excuse me, negative 1 third. And it's just an order of operations problem. We've substituted everything in that needs to be there. I've got negative 2 over negative 1 cubed times negative 8 thirds plus a negative 1 third. That's negative 9 thirds or negative 3. A positive 2 times a negative 3 is negative 6 for our answer. Now, this section is designed to be a two-day section. You can clearly see that the problems involve a lot of writing, and if we want to get the right answer, we'd better be diligent about writing out our steps cleanly so we can see if we missed a link in a chain, we can go back and fix it without having to start the whole problem over. It's very easy to get lost if we try and do too much in our heads. Here's a look at your assignment for this section. And that's it.